Good morning, everybody. I will talk today about the novel signaling cascade that regulates growth of cyanobacteria according to CO2. And actually, why I get interested in this high CO2 business, it's simply because of the weird phenotype of one of our RNA polymerase mutants. So delta-RPO sets cells that are missing the tiny omega subunit of RNA polymerase do not acclimate to high CO2, practically not at all. So when we grow those cells in normal ambient air, they grow just similar as the wild type cells that we called as a control strain cells. And when we transfer cells to high CO2, 3% CO2, these control cells grow much faster than in ambient air. But these delta-RPO set cells, they do not grow faster. Actually, the culture grows few days similarly in air and in high CO2, and then the cells just dead completely within less than a week. And what is this omega subunit, just to remind for those ones who are not so familiar with RNA polymerase? It's a small, tiny 7 kilodalton subunit in RNA polymerase. And it's typically non-essential in bacterial RNA polymerases, but it's essential in eukaryotic RNA polymerases. And if we compare the structure of that RNA polymerase in different bacteria species like E. coli, Thermus aquaticus, and Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we see that the structure differs a lot between different bacteria. And actually, the biological role of this subunit is unclear. It has been suggested to have a structural role to help assembly of RNA polymerase and also secure RNA polymerase structure. But as I told, it's typically non-essential. So the structural role cannot be really important. There are some evidence from different bacteria that it might have also a regulatory role. It seems to affect the recruitment of the sigma factors. And in synecocystis, we have seen which promoters the RNA polymerase with primary sigma factor recognize. So in synecocystis, in just ambient air, the NDH complex seems to be downregulated in this omega-less strain. And to start, the effect of high CO2, how it enhances the growth, we want to see that which genes are actually involved in this enhancement. This just shows 14 our video how the cells are grown in ambient air and in high CO2. These are just the control strain cells. And we made DNA microarray experiments where we transfer a cell from ambient air to high CO2 for 1 hour and 24 hours, and then compare the expression of genes in 1 hour samples to those ones in ambient air, and then 24-hour samples to those in 1 hour in high CO2. And this now shows how the genes that show differential expression behave. What was clearly downregulated and heavily downregulated were those bicarbonate transporters, PIC-A and this PCT1 and SPTA. Also, carboxysome proteins were downregulated, but just to some extent and more slowly. NDH genes were also highly downregulated and remained highly downregulated. Phycobilisome genes were upregulated. Also, photosystem 1 genes were downregulated, but quite slowly, and photosystem 2 genes were commonly upregulated. And for carbon-benzene Paham cycle enzymes, coding proteins, they show some differences, but not very big ones. Nitrogen metabolism genes were first upregulated, but only transiently. So after 24 hours in high CO2, the expression has returned to the original level. Phosphate transporters upregulated, and translation and transcription machineries were also first highly upregulated, but then returning back to the normal ambient air level. And these known regulators of high CO2, some of them were first downregulated. For example, this activator of this PCT1 bicarbonate transporter, it was first downregulated and remains downregulated. these NDHs was first down-regulated and then up-regulated. And this was quite weird because these genes, this is a repressor proteins, and this, also these genes were down-regulated, even if the repressor protein should reduce in this point. And then there were some histidine kinases and response regulators that also respond to high CO2. But if we go back to the delta RBLZ and why it's not growing well in high CO2, we compare the expression of genes in delta RBLZ to those of the control strain. And what we noticed that there were that kind of group of genes that show clearly difference between the delta RBLZ and control strain. And first group are the photosynthetic genes. So if we compare the gene expression after 24 hours in high CO2, phycobilism genes were mainly downregulated. Many of the photosystem 2 genes were downregulated. Cytochrome PF complex genes were downregulated. Photosystem 1 genes were downregulated. ATP synthase genes were really highly downregulated. Carboxysom genes were slightly downregulated. And also many of these Calvin-Benson cycle enzymes were downregulated in our delta RBLZ strain. So cells are not growing fast in high CO2. And of course, if the photosynthetic activity or photosynthetic complexes are not normally upregulated, that's not a surprise. Also, nitrogen uptake and assimilation genes were downregulated, especially nitrate transporters were highly downregulated. And also these nitrate and nitrate reductases were downregulated and glutamine synthetases. Whereas the glutamine synthetase inactivating factors were upregulated. So clearly the nitrogen uptake and assimilation were downregulated in our delta RBLZ cells in high CO2. And for phosphate transporters, one of the phosphate transport operands was downregulated, whereas the other one was not. And then third group of genes that were clearly downregulated in delta RBLZ are the genes that are involved in synthesis of peptidoglycan layer. So in cyanobacteria, the cell wall is composed of the cytoplasmic membrane, outer membrane, and then this peptidoglycan layer in between. And peptidoglycan layer is composed of the peptidoglycan monomers containing two different sugars and then tetrapeptide. And the synthesis of these peptidoglycan monomers occurs inside the cell by these Moore enzymes. And then the monomers are flipped on the other side of the cell membrane. And then inside the periplasmic base, these penicillin binding proteins then make the polymers and also this cross-linking of this peptidoglycan layer. And those genes encoding those enzymes shown here with the blue are the ones that are downregulated in our delta RBLZ cells. So it seems that there is something wrong with the peptidoglycan synthesis in the mutant. To get more idea about that, we also follow the growth of delta RBLZ cell in high CO2. And now I show you more than one cell because different cells behave differently. You can focus first here. So there are cells that are doing nothing. But then there are cells that are dividing. If you look here, they divide and then they explode. You can see next explosions then here. So they start to divide and then they explode. And of course, this is the main reason why we have the extinction of this culture early, because cells do not survive. We think that this is because of the impaired peptidoglycan synthesis. We can actually mimic this phenomenon by adding ampicillin to normal cell culture, control cell in ambient air. So if we add the ampicillin, there are only few dividing cells and those cells that divide explode. And I think that if the peptidoglycan layer is not forming properly, cells just simply take too much water inside and because of that explode. So delta RBLZ cells do not acclimate to high CO2 because they do not synthesize proper peptidoglycan layer. And then they have acclimation problems of photosynthetic machinery and also nitrogen and phosphate uptake is highly downregulated. But the next question is, of course, why this happens if the omega subunit is missing? What is the reason for this? The suppressor lines give some answers to us for this question. Sometimes when we put the delta RPOZ cells to high CO2, they were actually growing quite nicely. And actually, we then started the cultures from the plates that has been straked many times before we started the experiments. And then we just spread that kind of growing culture on plate, take single colonies, and tested those ones that are growing well in high CO2 not, and then select three colonies for further studies and sequence those ones. So here you can see two of the strains showing that they grow as well as the control strain in high CO2. And when we sequence those ones, we notice that they actually have mutation all in the same gene and only in that gene. And that gene is SSR1600. And the mutation in one strain, leucine 24 to serine, and in two other strains, we get the same mutation. And what is this SSR1600 protein? It's a homolog of anti-sigma factor F antagonist of Bacillus subtilis. It's a 10 kilodalton protein, and we know already that it's a phosphoprotein in cyanobacteria. And what does this anti-sigma factor antagonist then do? They regulate the recruitment of sigma factors. So typically these anti-sigma factors antagonist functions with anti-sigma factors. And this anti-sigma factor either interacts with anti-sigma factor antagonist or sigma factor. And if anti-sigma factor binds to sigma factor, it prevents the recruitment of that sigma factor by the RNA polymerase core. So this sigma factor is not able to interact with RNA polymerase core if it's bound to anti-sigma. And if this happens, it's regulated by this anti-sigma factor antagonist. Typically, these anti-sigma factor antagonists are regulated via phosphorylation. If the protein is phosphorylated, it cannot interact with anti-sigma factor. But when it's not phosphorylated, it interacts with anti-sigma factor, and in that case, that releases the sigma factor that can be then recruited by the RNA polymerase core. If we now look at these our suppressor lines, what happens to gene expression? What we see is that unlike in delta RPOZ strain, the gene expression remains, for example, for carbon concentrating mechanism genes. They express just like in control strain. In some cases, like ATP synthase genes, they are still downregulated, but not as heavily as in delta RPOZ. And for example, this Calvin-Benson cycle enzyme genes, they just express normally in these suppressor mutant lines, unlike in delta RPOZ strain. However, phosphate transporter genes remains downregulated, and also quite many of these nitrogen uptake genes remains quite heavily downregulated also in the mutant strain, but not that much as in the delta RPOZ strain. So this explains that gene expression occurs more similarly as in the control strain, and that's why cells are able to grow in high CO2. But of course, the real question is that which sigma factor this anti-sigma factor antagonist then regulates. And to get answer for that, we have these nine different sigma factors in synecocystis. SIG-A is the primary sigma factor. Then we have four group 2 sigma factors that resemble the primary sigma factor but are non-essential. And we know that these are important for the acclimation of synecocystis to different stress conditions. And then we have these group 3 sigma factors that are structurally more different than these. Five of these sigma factors is involved in virus synthesis. This is obligatory, but otherwise we do not know really for what things these are important. And to really analyze that which sigma factors forms an holoenzyme with this core in a certain time point, we added there a histac in the gamma subunit of RNA polymerase and then pull down the whole complex, and then using Western plotting and specific antibodies, we detect the amount of different sigma factors in RNA polymerase core or this holoenzyme. The sigma factor that shows clear differences was 6C. The total amount of 6C in different strains and in different conditions did not show any difference. But what we see in the holoenzyme, if we look at the control strain, the amount of 6C goes down in high CO2, And in suppressor mutant lines, it goes similarly down. But in delta RPOZ strain, the amount of 6E in holoenzymes goes up upon the high CO2 treatment. And what we have shown before is that this 6E is a growth-restrict sigma factor. So if we force synucocystis cells to a stationary phase by taking nitrogen away from the growth medium, the cells that have 6E as their only remaining group 2 sigma factors do not recover efficiently from that nitrogen deficiency after the addition of nitrogen back. They do recover, but more slowly. As you can see here, this control strain has completely recovered after first day. These delta sig PDE cells have not. Same can be seen if we have this 6S small regulatory RNA deletion strain. Also, that recovers slowly from nitrogen depletion. After we add the nitrogen back, it takes longer time to recover. And that also have a lot of 6E in RNA polymerase holoenzyme during the initial period of the recovery. What we think happens here that in control strain and both suppressor mutant strains, cells can only recruit low amount of 6E, and because of that, these photosynthetic genes, cell division genes, and nutrient uptake genes are highly upregulated and cells grow fast. Whereas in delta RPOZ strain, they make abnormally high amount of RNA polymerase holoenzyme with 6E. And because of these photosynthetic genes, cell division genes, and nutrient uptake genes are downregulated. We produce an antibody against this SSR1600 genes because the question is that how is downregulated the 6E sigma factor? And what we notice is that actually both of these suppressor mutant lines are almost completely missing this protein. We have two forms of this protein. This non-phosphorylated form and then phosphorylated form. And these proteins have been now separated using the FosTag cell so that we can efficiently separate the non-phosphorylated and phosphorylated form of protein. And then you can see here also a non-specific protein band. But if you look at this SSR1600 protein, both suppressor mutant line 1 and suppressor mutant line 2, they have very low amount of this non-phosphorylated protein, and we do not see the phosphorylated form at all. So these mutations make this protein very unstable. And if you now think that how this protein system functions, this SSR1600 protein forms a complex with anti-sigma factor, anti-6E, and this anti-6E can also form a complex with 6E. If we think that we have very low amount of this SSR1600 protein, of course this complex cannot form, and this anti-6E efficiently forms complex with 6E, and amount of free 6E is very low, and that's why it's not incorporated into RNA polymerase core, and these suppressor mutant cells can grow nicely. According to this system, if we have more of this anti-sigma factor antagonist SSR1600, in that case, we should have more free 6E. And to test that if this really happens, we overexpress this SSR1600. And what we see is that those cells are really growing more slowly in high CO2 than the control cells, but better than the delta RPOZ cells. Then the question is, of course, that who is this anti-6E? 3D modeling predicts that there is an interaction between this SSR1600 and SLR1861 protein. This interaction is regulated by phosphorylation, because if serine 59 is phosphorylated, that weakens the interaction. So it seems that this interaction occurs only if this SSR1600 is non-phosphorylated. This SLR1861, this anti-6E factor gene, is highly downregulated in delta RPOZ in high CO2, but only in high CO2. And we do not yet have an antibody against this protein. But if this protein is also downregulated and not only the transcripts, then it means that in delta RPOZ we have less anti-6E in high CO2 conditions than the control strain. And if we have the less amount of anti-6C factor, it means that we have more free 6C. And that's why the delta RPO test strain contains a lot of this holoenzyme containing 6C, and gene expression is downregulated. And this is just part of that kind of gene cluster that contains also 1-phosphatase and 2 other anti-sigma factor antagonists. To summarize, the omega-less RNA polymerase recruits more 6C than the intact RNA polymerase in high CO2. And because of that, there is a low expression of photosynthetic genes, and the photosynthesis does not acclimate properly to high CO2. It also affects the 6C peptidoglycan synthesis genes, so there is impaired peptidoglycan synthesis that causes cell death. And we also noticed that there are few cell divisions. There are plenty of cells that do not start cell division at all. So the cell division itself has to be somehow regulated. SSR1600 functions as an anti-6C antagonist, and SLR1861 is a putative anti-6C factor. Together, this SSR1600, SLR1861, and 6C forms a signaling cascade. And it clearly functions as a signaling cascade that regulates growth according to CO2, but it might also be involved in regulation of other processes. And this just summarized how we think that this system functions. We do not know what is the signal from high CO2 or low CO2, but in high CO2 conditions, unknown kinase phosphorylates SSR1600, and because of that, SLR1861 interacts with 6C that is not then recruited by RNA polymerase core, but other sigma factors are. And photosynthetic cell division and nutrient uptake genes are actively expressed and cells are growing fast. When cells are put to low CO2 conditions, most probably the phosphatase is activated. We do not know yet who is this phosphatase. And when this phosphatase is active, it dephosphorylates SSR1600 that then interacts with SLR1861 and releases the 6C that is recruited by RNA polymerase core, and then these genes are downregulated. I would like to thank current and previous members of my group who has been doing this work. Juha has done most of the work. And Taras and Esa has been involved in those photosynthesis and also nitrogen deficiency measurements. And Wolfgang and his group has done those microRNA analyses for us. Tiina Salminen and Serhi Vakal and Julia has made those 3D modeling for us. And then with Ilka, we studied that 6S deletion mutant quite some time ago. And then I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions or comments.